In this video, we're finally talking about Twinmotion, a real-time renderer that up until a few months ago wasn't really considered a strong engine. But now with this new update, it just changed everything. They added HDRI and Path Tracer, so now they go right against the major competitors. And after a bit of testing, I feel that it's one of the best options out there when it comes to real-time renderings, not only in terms of quality, render speed, and compatibility, but also in its licensing model, especially when we're talking about free student licensing. Okay, so you guys have asked me extensively to talk about Twinmotion here, and the reality is that without a proper rendering engine, it wasn't really worth trying out and making a video about it. But since the release of the HDRI feature, but more specifically the Path Tracer one, it really sparked some interest in me. And to top it all off, last week the Twinmotion team reached out asking if I wanted to partner it up for a couple of videos. So this video is sponsored by Twinmotion, but all the comments, reactions, and opinions are mine and genuine, okay? Now, the goal of this video is to get the discussion rolling of whether or not Twinmotion is a good alternative, and I'm gonna share my view on it by trying and experimenting with this image that you just saw. Now, there are loads to talk about, so let's get to the process, and be sure to leave your input down in the comments, because I wanna know what render engine you use and if you think Twinmotion has what it takes. So this project is inspired by Inarquitectura, which is a form that I like and have been following for a long time. I gave it a twist to the space, but if you want to check their work, links down in the video description. The 3D model was done in SketchUp, and it's really cool that Twinmotion has plugins for all major 3D software and even BIM, so you can seamlessly integrate your model to the render engine. And even large firms like Zaha and Big use Twinmotion at some point in their workflow. That's really cool to know. Now, this video won't cover all the little steps, but will give you a general idea of what working with Twinmotion feels like, and even the process of post-production in Photoshop at the end of this video. Again, with all my comments and opinions. And even though this is my first time using it, I've watched a couple of tutorials on YouTube, and I gotta say that Twinmotion YouTube channel has a bunch of those. They are very technical and focused on specific things. I'm gonna also link it down in the video description, so if you're new to this software, I highly recommend checking it out. Okay, so to synchronize your model, the plugin works as simple as this. You just click on Synchronize on the 3D, and then on Twinmotion, Import, Direct Link, and choose the source. That's it. It's now synchronized, and for every change you make, you just need to click on that button again to resync everything. Now, my first steps here in Twinmotion are what I always do when visualizing something. I create a scene so that you know what's visible and what's not. This ensures that you work on the stuff that matters, and what's behind camera doesn't really matter that much. Now, one thing that I really enjoyed about Twinmotion is the user interface, the UI. It's very intuitive, and unlike other real-time renderers I tested, it's all centered in the same view. So for example, to create a scene, you don't need to go to a separate window to set it up. And if you change the aspect ratio, which I almost always do, it shows directly on the working viewport. And I think this is really important for a visualization process. Okay, so after roughly creating the scene, let's start tweaking the materials. I'll come back to refine the scene and overall rendering settings after the materials are all taken care of. Materials. Here's the thing, when it comes to materials, the quicker you can get through them, the better. And what I mean by that is that not all materials in your scene need to be the best or really that precise. Most of them can be somewhat generic because they won't be that visible, to be honest. And then you spend more time and refine the ones that are actually important. In my example here, like the rug, concrete flooring, concrete stairs, and beam. Got it? So if you're deciding to use a new render engine as your main one, having a ready-to-use library of materials, a library that's already set up to look good in the render engine, is something to look after. It will really speed up your visualization process. And that's something that I liked about Twinmotion. It has a wide variety of textures and assets. And also, and I think most importantly, it has an integration with Quixel, which I'll talk more about in just a second. Now, what I didn't like that much, but maybe because I need to get used to it, I felt that it's not that easy to get advanced with the settings here, like adding extra channels and fine-tuning to get more complex results. Now, this process of setting up materials may be the longest in our render setup, because you do need to go to every little material and change it, or at least add a bit of reflection and or grunge. Okay, so these are for the generic materials, the ones that are not that visible. Now, for the important materials, you have two options. One is to take advantage of the Quixel connection Twinmotion has. If you've never heard about Quixel, let me introduce to you pretty quickly. Quixel is worldwide famous for providing textures, mega scans, and even 3D high quality models. Honestly, it was out of reach for most of my workflows because of the file compatibility. I mean, it was just too much trouble. But now you can access it directly from Twinmotion and download whatever surfaces or models you need. This does increase the options considerably, and I actually ended up using a lot of the textures available here. It's as simple as downloading and using it. It's really cool and all, you just gotta pay attention to the scale, but I wouldn't say it's as good as a paid professional PBR material, like those available to purchase from Polygon, for example. And this now leads me to the second option. You can use external textures with all the channels here. It's just a matter of adding them to the correct location and you're good to go. Like here with this rug, I added initially in SketchUp to properly wrap it with the projected texture. And then just added the bump channel and reflection channel here in Twinmotion. But this is something I still need to further explore to fully understand. Because what I felt with these settings is that Twinmotion wants to make this simpler and more accessible. But because I'm coming from other engines where more technical options are easily accessible, I felt a bit lost here, to be honest. Okay, so after setting up all the materials, I'm adding extra things that weren't included in SketchUp. Listen, usually, and if you've been following the channel for a long time, I'm a big fan of adding some things in Photoshop during post-production, but this is really due to the lack of good and reliable assets in the 3D software. It's really hard to get a detailed house plan in SketchUp that will look good in a render, for example. But whenever I have them with these here inside the renderer, which I have seen in other real-time renderers out there, but now especially with this Quixel integration here in Twinmotion, it just doesn't make sense to add as 2D assets in Photoshop later. So I'm taking full advantage of the ready to use library here. The only downside is that you don't have an infinite variety to choose from, because for example I had some cases where the project demanded a very specific type of plant and the only solution was to use from a 2D cutout. HDRI. Okay, up until now it was the usual Twinmotion everyone was used to, but the change begins with the addition of the HDRI. This just dramatically changes everything. Well, not by itself, it needs the Path Tracer that we'll talk more in just a minute, but now with an HDRI, you don't rely on the render engine sunlight to light up your scene, which usually lacks complexity and life. It's just one generic source of light. Now you can use the extensive library of HDRI maps that Twinmotion has to offer, or even import your own custom one, which personally opens a whole new world of possibilities. This, for example, is something that Lumion doesn't offer. It has HDRIs, but you're limited to a small sample that they will give you. So here I'm getting into the image settings, selecting my scene, and then under lighting, here it is, Sky Dome. There are a bunch of possible ways to light up your scene, but from what I understand, if you want to rely solely on the HDRI map, which is a more realistic light, and obviously here in my case, the lamps that will light up in just a second, you need to turn down the sun intensity and I guess moon intensity too. Now, this doesn't look good, does it? Well, in order to see the changes, we need to switch to the Path Tracer mode. This is a totally new feature and it's what brought Twinmotion to the table, honestly. Unfortunately, it requires a really powerful machine, so it's worth checking the requirements to see if your PC meets it. But if yours doesn't meet, you can go to the settings and change to DirectX 12 to enable it. Okay, so here's the Path Tracer button, and as soon as you click it, you can already see the difference. There's a whole technical side of this Path Tracer, but to not overcomplicate things, it renders and calculates the lights in a much more realistic way, which real-time renderers didn't have the tendency to do so. For quick testing, be sure to click on the little arrow and switch to low quality. Okay, so now with the Path Tracer enabled, we can go to the library, find the Sky Dome category, and replace the HDRI map. You may need to download the chosen one first. This interior scene that I have here is not ideal to showcase how big of a change the HDRI is, but I've got an exterior video planned out, and there I'll explore this feature a lot more. But the Path Tracer is noticeable in any type of image, especially when I light up the lamps. Which I'll do now to finish this render. I'm lighting up the visible lamps by making the materials emissive. And I've seen some people light up the scenes only with the emissive materials, but I wanted to test the spot and area's light too. This is over intuitive and easy. My only issue is that it needs to be in the Path Tracer mode to properly see the changes and some settings. So it may take a bit longer to properly tweak the strength of each lamp to make the scene balanced, you know? Now, interior lights are almost always warmer, and I've even specified 2700 to even 3000 Kelvin lamps to some projects, but if I input that value to the render, it gets too yellow-orange. But this is something I'm not too worried about, because it's very easy to fix in Photoshop later. Oh, and I was almost forgetting, I'm taking full advantage of the nature library to cover these walls back here in plants. This could have also been done later in Photoshop, especially because it's far away from the camera. Okay, so we've taken care of pretty much everything here, but now the final render needs more quality. So inside the render settings, activate Path Tracer to see its options, and I'm increasing the samples to at least 512 to really get that crisp look. And light bounces, you can also increase it a bit. Again, the Twinmotion YouTube channel has a lot more technical stuff over this. I highly recommend checking it out. Now, all we gotta do is export. And while this is exporting, let me talk about the biggest thing that's missing here. Render elements. Can you believe it? For me, it's such a core part of visualization that, in a way, all the improvements that were made go out of the window because of it. It makes the post-production process so much harder and longer. Twinmotion has got to get a handle on this, and fast. And as I said, I really wanted to be honest here. This was too important to not talk about. I think it's something for you to consider. Personally, because of this new update, the Path Tracer and HDRI, the ease of use, high quality outputs, and the immense library, still wanna make me use it. Nonetheless, a Twinmotion render can benefit a lot from post-production in Photoshop. Honestly, any render really, it's a core part of the process. But without the render elements, you cannot really go all in. We're just gonna do some small fixes here, like here on the rug. And this is obviously because a low quality 3D rug model that I used back in SketchUp. Then the concrete feels too dark and dirty for this interior. So with some selections I pre-made, I can add some adjustments to reduce the contrast and lighten it up. Next, I'm using a brightness and contrast adjustment layer to reduce the overall exposed lights. Usually in real life, there's no such thing as pure white or pure black, usually, okay? This also brings back some of the details of the lamp, just slightly though. This still needs to look like it's lit up. And obviously, no 3D software or render engine places people's cutouts as good as Photoshop can do. I'm gonna link some videos I have here on the channel that talk about placing cutouts in the video description. But the tip I give you is to do not forget to add the reflections on the floor, because it really helps to make the cutout feel in place. And also try to match the color and values of this cutout to the scene. Don't be afraid to use a bunch of layers to make this possible. And then lastly, as always, the final move. Create a copy of everything with the shortcut Ctrl+Shift+Alt+E, then convert it into a smart object so that you can always come back later to adjust it, and then apply a camera raw filter. It's here that you will be able to fine-tune everything. I mean, every image is different, but for this scene, I can increase the exposure, but lower the highlights, and even increase the shadows a bit. Some textures to punch in some detail, a few other adjustments here on the camera raw, and that's it. Here's the final result. I really enjoyed this process. Real-time renderers are growing on me, to be honest. The quality it outputs in such a short process is striking, and I don't see much of that game-like look I've seen in other renderers. But again, I still need to test it in multiple occasions to see how I feel. One of the biggest features, if you can call it a feature, is the student licensing. You can download it free of charge and use the full extension of the software without any watermarks or reduced render quality. And that's such an important thing in my opinion. So all of your architecture school projects can benefit from fast and reliable renderings. And your school doesn't need to be licensed with them or anything, and they don't ask for any student ID. You obviously cannot use it for commercial use, but you can learn it all, get better, and do your architecture school projects to build a portfolio. But now, I want to hear from you guys. What do you think about Twinmotion? Have you used it before? Is it your main render engine at the moment? I'm eager to get the conversation rolling on this. As I said, this has been a highly requested topic. Thanks a lot for watching. If you made it until here and enjoyed this video, be sure to give it a like. This really helps with the algorithm. Also, subscribe to not miss any new videos. And if you have any suggestions for future ones, be sure to leave it in the comments. And I'll see you guys in the next video.